Welcome to Blue Blood TV Season 6, Episode 13. And we're going to call this show Tobacco Road is Burning. Can Carolina hold off a surging Duke in the ACC race? The stakes are as high as the bell tower itself. North Carolina clings to a one-game lead in the ACC, and doubts are swirling whether they could keep the ACC title. Over at Duke, Duke has roared back with a three-game win streak, and their eyes are set on stealing the conference crown. This episode dives deep into the hottest rivalry in college sports as the Tar Heels and Blue Devils prepare for an epic clash on March 9th. And we're going to analyze Carolina's struggles, Duke's resurgence, key players to watch, predictions with the one and only Daryl Brunson, with the one and only Will Phelan. And we've got a special guest today, Derek C. Wittenberg from the 1982 National Championship NC State team. And we're going to talk about the ACC, and we're going to talk about his book called Shot Heard Around the World. What's up, guys? How are you guys doing?
Great, man.
Great, fellas. How are you?
Doing well.
All right. So this weekend has been up and down. Carolina has lost two of its last three, Will. And Duke, Daryl, on the other side, has won three games in a row since coming off the February 3rd Carolina-Duke game. So, Will, what's going on?
You know, it's interesting because we go out and we beat Miami, and I mean, Miami's down this year, but they were still a Final Four team last year. I think that Syracuse game, I mean, anytime you go up against an opponent that shoots 63% from the field, you're gonna have a tough time, right? So we need guys to step up. Who we need everybody to step up at the same time. I think if you look at that,
but you got that, Will. You got that. You had Harrison Ingram, 14 points, 11 rebounds, 3 assists. You got that. Amando, 14, 10 and 3. Cormac Ryan, 18 points.
He finally found his shot.
He found his shot in this last game against Syracuse. RJ Davis, he just did a cool 19 points, 3 assists. Okay. Only problem you're having is this Elliot Cadeau guy, 4 points, 31 minutes, 1 rebound, 7 assists. Will, is Elliot Cadeau your problem?
I don't think he is. I mean, the Syracuse game is just kind of a flash in the pan, right? You shoot 63%. We out rebounded him. We had more assists. We did have 5 more turnovers, which isn't great, but I mean, you have 11 turnovers in a game. That's not awful. That shouldn't kill you. It's just one of those things, man. We hit a hot team. And if you go back to the Miami game, Elliot Cadeau had 19 points, 8 assists. So we just need him to find a shot. It almost looks like he's a pass first kind of guy where he had plenty of wide open 3-point looks in that Syracuse game and just chose to get rid of the ball instead. So we need him to confidence, maybe. I don't know. Help me out here. But
okay, Will, I'm going to bring the basketball guy into the conversation.
Please. Mr.
Derek C. Wittenberg. Derek, I don't know how much of you've been watching of Carolina. You know, Will and I have gone back and forth on Elliot Cadeau. I think he's a nice point guard. I don't think he's a great point guard. I think he's a little undersized. But Derek, give us your evaluation of Elliot Cadeau.
Elliot Cadeau, if he gets the confidence in his shot, is going to be one of the best point guards to play at Carolina. And the reason why I say that he has the ability, he's got the quickness and speed to go by anybody when he wants to. He can also pass the basketball, which most point guards don't like to pass. Most of them are shoot first and not pass first. So you like a point guard that distributes the ball to everybody. And if he gets the confidence in his 3-point shot and starts to knock out, you got to respect him. Mm-hmm. And I think the point guard's key. Listen, guys. So I'm speaking from 66 championships, 35 wins, 6 Hall of Fame coaches, 2 national championships, And what I'm saying to you at the end of the game with 5 minutes to go, you can throw all the stats you want, guys. But at the end of the day, you have to finish the game with 5 minutes to go. You can talk about points all for 35 minutes. But at the end of the game, the guards are going to have to make the plays to finish the game at the end of the game. By the way, when you go on the road, 36% of the time, you're going to lose. So it's hard to win on the road. Everybody thinks, oh, I'm a top five team. I'm a top 10 team. Well, that doesn't matter. When you go on the road, you can get beat. So going on the road, God, is not as easy what it sounds. Everybody just expects, oh, we're going to go on the road and we're just going to beat Syracuse. Well, no, it ain't going to happen. We're going to go on the road and we're just going to beat this team. It's hard to win on the road, and especially in the ACC. And so that's what the dog days of February, when the ACC is in the grind and everybody's trying to close the season out and get to position themselves for the tournament, especially the ACC tournament, these are the toughest times for all teams.
Okay, so Derek, you're saying Carolina's been on the road. You're saying road wins are tough. Teams play better at home. So this is just part of the slog of getting through the ACC as a season. Is that what I'm hearing?
Absolutely. The formula for winning the league, which I did that in 96 with the Georgia Tech, and we did it again at NC State, and I believe, of course, Johnny Rodney Moreau's team in 89. The formula is win all your games if you can at home, or 90% of them, or 80% of them, because you're going to stumble. Somebody's going to meet you at home. And then try to win at least half of your games at home. If you do that with 20 wins, you probably can win 14, 15 games, you know, in the league, which is a whole lot of games in any conference, especially the ACC. So that's the formula. You listen, everybody goes, you know, Clemson played a tremendous game and upset Carolina at home. It can happen. But when you go on the road, anybody can beat you on the road if you're not ready to play. Plus, all teams play better at home, right? They all get jacked up. They're familiar with the surroundings, the rims and everything. So everybody's going to play better at home. And plus, when you're a top 10 team, you're going to get their best shot.
Mm-hmm.
You know, yeah. Carolina, Duke, the top teams, you're going to get the other team's best shot. Nobody expected Pitt to beat Virginia the other day, right? Virginia was the hot team. So, you know, when you're the top team, everybody's gunning for you. You're going to get their best shot.
Great analysis, Derek. Daryl, we're going to travel over to Durham and talk to my guy, Daryl Brunson. Daryl, Duke is hot. Duke is hot. Duke is hot. They're on a 3-game win streak, but two of their wins came from Notre Dame and Boston College, who are at the bottom of the ACC, Daryl. Are those three wins significant wins?
Absolutely significant. And I think, if nothing else, that Mr. Wittenberg here has just made a valid point for me, and it's that at this time of the year in conference play, it's difficult to win these games. And I think, you know, while the competition might not be at the height that it's normally at for the ACC, it's also still value in winning interconference games and winning these ACC games. And I think that that's evident. And like he was talking about Pitt upsetting Virginia, you know, these things happen. We've seen it with Duke. We've seen it with Carolina. The upsets happen. The unexpected losses come. So anytime you can get a win streak going, especially following an epic rivalry game in the Duke Carolina blue blood rivalry, to be able to pile on these wins right now following that, as opposed to going in the opposite direction, I think is a big thing. And I believe that it will be very pivotal for Duke moving forward to stack up a couple more of these victories. And if they take a loss or two in the midst of doing that, then I believe that's okay. But the build up to the next game for the blue blood rivalry right now looks in favor of Duke rather than Carolina.
Okay, Derek, I'm going to go back to you. Thank you for that analysis, Daryl. Derek, you're an outsider. We're not outsiders. We kind of look at Duke Carolina. We have our own internal biases. From an outsider's perspective, who has the better team, Duke or Carolina?
Well, obviously, Carolina has a veteran team, and so you have to give them an edge in terms of their veteran guys, and they look a little bit more mature. But you can throw that out the window because at the end of the day, Carolina had to go over to Duke, and that will be a tall task. Duke will be playing, the place will be rocking, the energy will be left. And say, let me tell you about the psyche of these games too, guys. Because I've been at two ACC schools. I worked 5 years at Georgia Tech, and I've been at NC State for four different occasions. So I've seen it on both sides. The psyche of the game is that the pressure is on the home team to win, not the road team. The road team is not expected to win. So the pressure is really on the home team because everybody just says, oh, you're going to, everybody, the place is going to be excited. But if you can keep that game close and keep the pressure and at the aim, be in position. Bob Allen used to talk about this all the time. Put yourself in position to win the game with 5 minutes to go. The psyche of the game, the pressure is on the home team. Got to remember, I was at the last game with Coach K when they played Duke. The last game, the place was rocking, and they had Coach K's shirts on, and the media and everybody was there. I was the only state guy there. I was the only guy in red in the whole building. Only guy.
I love it.
And, but I saw the pressure on Duke. He had a young team. I saw the pressure. RJ and Caleb Love came in there and dominated that game. They could not handle the guard play. And I just thought as the game mounted, Duke took an early lead. And then when they got down to the last 5 minutes, the Carolina guards just took control of the game. Mm-hmm. So that it was sometimes the pressure of you knowing that you're supposed to win looms large on your psyche, right? Because you're not expecting another team comes in a little loose. Hey, man, we just gonna come in here and play, keep the game close, and let's try to steal this thing at the end. So it's going to be important. And probably that game could be pivotal because at the end, somebody's going to probably be vying to see who's going to be number one in the conference at that time. If they all keep pace, meaning to take care of business. We talked about Duke. It doesn't matter. Whatever win you have at this time is an important win. Listen, Georgia Tech beat Carolina and Duke. And they can't beat nobody else, but obviously they are doing, Georgia Tech's doing something, right? Because why? At home, they played great. They beat Carolina, the kids got up, they played Duke, they got up. And sometimes it's the opposite. Your kids at Duke or Carolina goes into like a place at Georgia Tech and they go, oh man, they're last in the league. It's no problem. We're going to win this game. So sometimes it's psychological and the approach these kids take. You see, you cannot take anybody lightly in this league, no matter what position they're in. You got to prepare yourself to play. And these are the dog days of February in the ACC.
Derek, I love your insights. Will, we're going to come back to you. It looks like that Carolina cruise ship that was, cruising so good through the Caribbean has hit some high seas, bad weather, and it looks like it's listing. It's like tilted to the side a little bit.
An iceberg, Hassan.
An iceberg is hitting it, right, Daryl?
Hey, I don't know about that Duke education, but did you just say iceberg in the Caribbean, man? You got to look up some.
Look, it could
get out of here with that nonsense.
It could be a breakaway iceberg, a giant iceberg. We're in the era of global warming, Will. But the real question. The real question is, Will, do you have a problem? Is the cruise ship tilt the listing to the side? And what needs to happen? What does Hubert need to do to get this thing uprighted and sailing properly?
I don't think there's much of a problem. I think that it, in today's culture, whatever, we like to overreact. I think that we will be just fine. I do agree with Derek in that if we get Elliot Cadeau some confidence in his shot, that his game's going to figure itself out. And part of what made us so successful early on in that run that we had was his ability to kind of slash to the hoop. And if we can kind of get that going again, Armando's figured his thing out. Hopefully Cormac's figured his shot out. He had 18 the other night. So hopefully those kind of issues have taken care of themselves. And then Hubert's ability has shown us this season to adjust in game and from game to game with the lineup changes and the pressing that he does when we've just to kind of slow momentum and stuff for other teams. I think he'll figure it out. I really do.
So my problem with the last game, Will, is you had four guys in double digits. If four guys in double digits, four out of your five starters gave you good point productions and you still lost by 7 points. And I mean, attribute that to turnovers, and you won the rebound. You won the offensive and defensive glass. And so it seems like in the Syracuse game, you did so many things right. I mean, and you even shot 44% from 3 points. But you still lost. That's what's concerning me. What happened in that game?
I think with that game, it just boils down. So Syracuse's zone's been giving teams fits for decades at this point. But they shot 63%. Like anytime you go down, we still shot 47%. That should win you a lot of games. We out-rebounded them. The turnovers, yeah, that's a problem. We had 11, so you'd like to clean it up a little bit. But I think it goes back to their shooting. I mean, that kid Mintz, just he was jacking three contested threes up from the parking lot, and everything was going in. Those kids could not miss. And even late in that game, I mean, 7 points is 7 points. Yeah, the scoreboard, the final score, whatever. We fouled them a bunch down the stretch, and they went down and hit their free throws as well. So that 7 points is kind of inflated. We were tied and had a lead with 4 or 5 minutes to go in the second half. So it goes back to what Derek said, where you just with 5 minutes to go, your guards have to turn it on and you have to shut them down if you're gonna make a run. And 63%, anytime a team shoots that, you're gonna have to do more than we did. You can't turn the ball over. You can't do anything like that. You can't make the small mental mistakes.
No. Let me tell you the problem, Will. Let me tell you the problem. 3 points, 44%, you're fine. The problem is rebounding, you were fine. The problem was you guys had more possessions than Syracuse because you won the glass. Okay. Mm-hmm. Inside the 3-point line, you couldn't find your shots, right? Your team couldn't get to the bucket, right? So it goes back to where I was saying this team is a good team, but it might be too small to get to the rim. We're talking about Eli Cadeau slashing to the rim. I think he might be too small. Derek called him an athletic guard. I don't see an athletic guard. I see a guy that's a medium athlete, a little bit heavy.
I said, Hassan, you soccer. I said speed and quickness. I didn't say anything about athleticism. You're okay. A soccer guy, okay? So speed and quickness. I didn't say nothing about jumping over the basket and dunking, okay? Let me give you another analysis for you guys going. Let me tell you the psyche of the game, because I watched about 5 or 6 games a night, okay? I watched all the games. I watched NC State. I watched Duke. I watched the Big 12. I watched the Big 10. I watched the Pac-10. I watched more games than anybody, okay? Syracuse, Ardrey started playing 90% man-to-man. Syracuse is already known for the zone, but he's a different coach, and he took over for the great one, and now he's inflicting his personality on the Syracuse program. So he primarily played man-to-man. All of a sudden, they threw the zone out there, and they spread you out. Now, what the zone does, guys, it makes you shoot more outside shots and not shots inside.
Okay.
So you're going to feel like, why didn't I shoot? Because they want you to shoot outside shots, mm-hmm. right? That's what they want. They want you to, the lower percentage shots are to shoot the ball outside. Listen, when I played against Syracuse at Fordham, I shot them out of the zone. because the middleman is important to kill the zone. And if Baycott would have got more opportunities inside, play him, throw that ball in and let him make some plays inside, you would have had more two-point opportunities. That's first of all, how you attack the zone. You attack the zone from the middle and the short corner. Short corner, middle, middle to out. That's how you attack the zone, guys. So the psyche, when the game got to the end and they got a lead, they said, oh, we're not going to play man-to-man against Baycott. We're going to make them shoot the ball outside. We're going to keep them outside. We might lose a couple offensive rebounds, but that way we're not going to get beat up by Baycott. They're going to throw the ball inside. We're going to foul out. We got nobody can take care. So strategy for Audrey and Syracuse was brilliant at the end of the game. To inflict that zone, to kind of slow. It slows you down. It makes you pass the ball more. It takes the clock down. Great strategy on there. Here's the other thing I'm going to talk to you guys about Duke, Carolina, and all the teams going down the stretch. Early on, all the teams, Hubert and all the coaches early on, they played more players. They trusted more players. And more guys got more time. And you know why? Because it gave the starters rest. And when you give the starters rest, you're fresh at the end of the game. So sometimes at the end, fatigue will set in. If you're playing your guys 35, 36, 37-minute starters, it could be a factor in the end of the game. So down the stretch, who is going to trust their team? Virginia's getting deeper in their bench. Carolina early on was getting deep in the bench. Duke's starting to play more players. They starting to play at least 8 to 9, 10 guys. That's going to be a factor in trusting more guys to play down the stretch to give your starters a rest.
Yeah, Cormac played all 40 minutes in that game against Syracuse too. Like, that's not gonna help anybody out if you're running the entire game, you know.
Absolutely, absolutely. Not to say that he can't, and there's going to be a time where he can play. R.J. Davis probably can play 50 minutes, but R.J. Davis that plays 37 or 36 may be even more effective. You never know.
So along with what you're saying, then I think playing guys like Seth Trimble, where if you want to talk about athletic guards, like Trimble can jump out of the freaking – I mean, he's J.P. Tokido's brother, and we know how Tokido was in his time at Carolina. But if we play him more than 7 minutes, then that'll help us out, I think, long term.
Prepare for Duke and North Carolina to face off like never before. Blue Blood Rivalry 5K! 5K! Sign up one, sign up all! Students, families, alumni, locals, non-locals, everyone! And you don't even need to be from UNC or Duke! Because we have a Party Crasher division! Party Crasher! Come State, Wink, UVA, anyone, and join the fun! Party. But the real battle is between the Blue Devils and the Tar Heels. Before it's settled on the court, it'll be settled on the race course. But there's more. There will be a special basketball dribble division where each participant will travel the race course dribbling a basketball. Dribbling a basketball? Hell yeah! That's cool! So sign up now! Attention all racers, prepare for the event of a lifetime. The race course will certainly decide a champion school.
Carolina fans, download Duke Carolina, the Blue Blood Rivalry film on iTunes or Apple TV or wherever you get your VOD downloads.
Hey, Quinn,
you
come out of the room. Quinn, you know you my guy, right? I'm always putting you on. Night, when you step on the court, I step on the court too. We in it.
Doing two games that night. It's the North Carolina game at Duke and the Duke game that's at North Carolina.
Well, when we wake up on game day, there's a knot in my stomach. We've been up since 6 a.m. this morning watching recorded Duke-Carolina games.
I watched the Rivers shot
about 15 times.
Yeah.
Rivers on his own. Yes!
at the buzzer.
We're here for the Duke game.
And it is 10 hours and 9 minutes until game time.
The Blue Devils win 85-84.
Nothing better than North Carolina and Duke. It is the best rivalry in all of college basketball. Hall of Fame coaches, great players, and usually so much at stake.
And that's it.
The fans have as much to do with the rivalry being great as the players and the coaches.
It's 5 hours before game time.
Well, there's no question that the rivalry is there every day in our community.
Can you imagine what it would be like around here if people didn't have it? It would be terrifying.
We are 30 minutes away from tip-off.
It's one of the most exciting events you can be a part of, and I still say it's not the biggest rivalry in college basketball. It's the biggest rivalry in all of sport.
Bar none. It's game time. Daryl, quick question is, Duke a real contender or will they fall flat when they start to play the better half of the ACC going down to the stretch?
You know, Hassan, I'm really eager to answer your question. But first of all, I've been sitting over here thinking about the fact that Will said there's not an iceberg in the middle of the Caribbean. And I mean, I know that. I was in the middle of the Atlantic, but I'm not sure if Will would be on the float or not, considering he might be Rose or Jack. I'm not really sure, but I did want to get back to that point real quick. But hey, no, seriously.
I'd put you on the life raft, baby.
I appreciate you because I don't think you'd make it on the damn life raft, Will. Moving forward,
I'm gonna come by in a yacht and pick both of y'all up. So y'all okay. Won't have to worry about that,
okay? I knew I liked you.
I definitely appreciate that. But no, to answer your question, Hassan, I do think it's a contender. I think that right now they're finding their way. Kirk mentioned they're playing more players, but it is interesting enough that in the last game, they went back to the solid six. I mean, essentially six guys played 26 plus minutes in that game, 25 plus minutes. And the other guys they had, they sprinkled them in for a couple minutes here and there. I think that Scheyer is trying his best to find it, but I think most recently, Mark Mitchell is giving me hope that Duke may be able to turn it around and actually make a run. Because we've been talking all year about how their size has been their issue. Well, if Mitchell continues to play, dropping 23 points against Wake Forest, grabbing several boards, you know, and most recently in his games, he's been grabbing 7, 8, 10 rebounds. And we didn't see that earlier in the year. I think that if he can continue to assert that dominance next to Filipowski, it'll allow Filipowski to be the player that he wants to be as opposed to them trying to force him to be that strong guy in the middle that he's had to be over the last 3 months, considering Duke's lack of size. I think Mark Mitchell is going to be Duke's X factor moving forward.
Okay. All right. Do you think Mark Mitchell, I mean, the last game against Wake Forest, he got 23 points, but he's kind of up and down. Do you think you can count on this guy, Daryl?
I do think that you can count on him, but I think really, like I said, he just has to compliment Filipowski. He doesn't necessarily have to be that guy every night. But when he is that guy, Duke is a much better team. And so I think if he can be, as opposed to the Jared McCain's we've been talking about, the Tyrese Proctors, who, by the way, went scoreless this last game and they still won. If Mitchell can find a way to be just another presence in that post, it affords their other players like the Filipowskis and like your Jeremy Roaches and Jared McCain's. It affords them a night off from time to time. So I think, you know, on this Duke team with a solid six, any one of those six guys can step up night to night. But when it's the two guys inside, this team becomes a totally different team.
Okay, Derek, I want to get you in on and analyze Duke for me. Analyze what you think about John Scheyer. Has Duke found their rotation? Has John Scheyer gotten the best of all those five-star athletes that are sitting on his bench?
Absolutely, he has. But I want to go back to Mitchell. He's the junkyard dog. He's the X factor because you're worried about Roach and Proctor and Kachowski and all the other guys, right? You're worried about those guys. So he's kind of the forgotten guy. And he's an odd matchup because he's a 6'6 guy, athletic, left-handed, doesn't shoot the three all that well, so you leave him by himself sometimes. You leave him by himself in the middle of the floor with an easy three-point shot, he can make that shot, okay? Any guy in college, if you leave him by himself long enough, He's going to make some open three, but he slashes to the basket. He's hard to guard. He's the X factor. Listen, you need at least three guys consistently to score over double figures. If you get that fourth guy like Mitchell, that's the X factor. Nobody's expected. You don't expect. He got 23 points the other day. Nobody's expecting that. You know, on an off night, you know, if you get somebody scoring 23, you expect it. That's huge for your team. So Duke would Roach. I still think Roach is the key. And the reason why he's the veteran guy on the team, he's the guy at the end of the game. He gets to the basket. He'll make his free throws. More than likely, he's going to have the ball in his hand. And Scheyer, after timeout, if you guys notice, he runs that little ball handoff screen to get Roach going to the basket. That's a key play for them every timeout of a timeout. He gets Roach. If Roach is in the game, he's going to get Roach involved because he's a veteran guy. He's been there. He knows what to do. So this is going to be exciting down the road. Listen, there's a lot of teams in this, even state, as much, you know, we're 7-6 or something like that. You got a bunch of teams, 7-5, 6-6, 7. And then you got Duke and Carolina, Virginia. And you got Miami down there at 6-6, 6-7. So listen, these last 7 games or whatever, 8 games these guys got, it's going to be a lot of jockeying. So every game, to all you guys' point, is going to count. I don't care who you play, where you play them. Every game is critical at this time. And listen, we're going into my favorite month. After the dog days of February, you get to March Madness, baby. Survive in advance. That's my time.
Survive
in advance.
I love it.
And that's what you get from game to game. Survive in advance. That's my time, baby. That's the book's going to come out. That's when you're going to go, the shot heard around the world from how I went from the playground to the White House, baby.
Derek, we're going to do a whole entire segment on your book, Shot Around the World. We're just going to finish up with a couple more questions about UNC and Duke. And then we're going to shift topics, guys. And so stay with us because we're going to talk about the shot heard around the world. So, Will, we're just going to go back to you. Dean Smith always says your team never wants to peak in November, December, January, February. You want to peak in March.
I said that too, by the way.
Say that again. Say that again, Daryl.
I said that. I also said that. I'll give Dean his credit, you know, RIP, but I also said that.
Okay, that you also said that. Okay.
This in your Darryl geography class, Duke.
Yeah. So, Will, could UNC have peaked early? And now guys like Damon Stoudemire, there's some good coaches in this conference. There's some figured out like where their weak points are and forcing them to shoot shots they don't want to shoot as opposed to the shots that they do want to shoot. What are your thoughts on that, Will?
I don't think we peaked too early. I think the ACC is showing you why it's one of the toughest conferences year in and year out.
But we said that it's not. And Derek, you can come in there and you can. I don't think this conference is that good. I think the guys are small in this conference. I don't think I've seen us go up against a longer Connecticut. I've seen this conference go up against a Kentucky and we haven't done well. So this conference is not great.
I still think this conference is showing us why it's one of the best year in and year out. I'm not saying it's the best conference this year by any means. But what I do think, though, is records are inflated by out-of-conference schedules, right? And so you look at the Big 12, for example, who's got, 8 ranked teams in the top 25. If you go look at their out-of-conference schedules, they're soft. They're not that good. And, guys, I think there are a lot of teams in the ACC who have had their records kind of deflated, so to speak, by their tough out-of-conference schedules. That being said, I don't think this team peaked too early. I think – the first time we played Syracuse at home, we went out and beat the brakes off them, and their coach came out and said that we're the toughest team he's played all season. And then you look at the adjustments that Derek pointed out that he was able to make that second game and even in the second half of the second game. And it's tough to beat a team twice, right? Especially in conference when you go into their building against their fans with their – we've pointed out in previous episodes that home teams are going to get that little home team sway from the refs too. So it's tough to go into an away environment in conference and beat a team a second time. I think that – did we lose him?
No, he's still here. Keep going.
No, I think that if we make the adjustments that Derek pointed out earlier that we've been talking about, where we got Trimble defensively, he missed three games. So if we can have him slide back in, Cormack figures his shot out, Cadeau starts gashing into the or towards the bucket and then dishing it out to RJ, and we get a lot of open shots by swinging the ball around when Cadeau slashes to the hoop. So I think if we do the little things, we stop turning the ball over quite as much, I think we'll be fine.
Okay. Hey, Derek, are you still there? Are you still on the line? I think you are you still there, Derek?
Oh yeah, I'm still here. I'm kind of like a stepchild here, you know, like I'm on the outside. Y'all talking Duke and Carolina, you know, I'm just a little state guy over here.
We're about to focus on you. Last question for you, Derek, is do you think Cuban has a problem? Are the other coaches in the ACC, have they evaluated, analyzed tape? And are they forcing his team into positions and shots that they don't want to take? And do you think Huber can get this thing going again?
Oh, absolutely. You know, I'm tied to Hubert a little bit more. When we lost the late Walter Davis, his uncle, Walter and I was at camp together in Phoenix, and he took great care of me, even though I got cut. But Walter really took care of me, and I just my hat's off to Walter and their family and everything, and my condolences. But I think he's doing an outstanding job. I think all of our coaches are doing an outstanding job at ACC. This is hard. It's hard to win, and it's hard when you got the target on your back. So I think he's learning. This is his first time being a head coach, guys. You know, and then the expectations shut up when you go to the championship game. And you beat Carolina twice in your first year. So, you know, this is year, you know, he's still learning, still trying to inflict his personality on the program. I think he's going to do fine. What happens now is that you're scouted pretty well. People have your tendencies. They know what you want to do. Listen, everybody know you want to get the ball to Baycott. They know J.R. Davis is going to tell you. He's going to score 20 points no matter what you do to him. Is just shutting down all the other guys. So I think he's making some nice adjustments. I think he's doing great. The only thing is, when I look at the league from my perspective, when I used to look at Carolina, I used to look at Michael Jordan and James Worthy. There was something you had to contend with. I'm not saying we don't have good players, but when I played, you look at two or three pros on each team. Correct. And that may be the difference of what we see now. League is still very good, but now there was a pro on every team. Mm-hmm. And so there was a guy, you saw Larry Nance at Clemson. You went, oh, my God, Larry Nance at Clemson. Oh, my God. You know, like you got Tim Duncan at Wake Forest. Like you had some guys on there. On every one of these teams, you went like, well, we had Stephon Marbury at Georgia Tech. He's the best guard I've ever seen. He destroyed the league as a freshman. Destroyed. So the talent level hasn't been where we're accustomed to. You know, we hadn't had the NBA quite talent, but we still had it. We still have a very good league. But the talent level is spread out around the country. If you guys, you remember, even you young guys growing up, both of you, if you look, the ACC used to have at least probably 30 out of the top 100 easily in the country. Now, if you look around, those kids are spread out across the country because of the transfer portal, NIL. So the ACC is no longer the destination for the great five-star players.
Yeah, this is a good segue because I want to talk about 1983 was the year you won the national championship. And that year with Jimmy V, you had to go through the likes. Let me tell you who was on Carolina's roster that year. A TNT sports analyst named Kenny Smith, Matt Doherty, Brad Doherty, Sam Perkins, and the one and only Michael Jordan. That's 4 out of 5, not NBA players, but legendary NBA players. Did I get that right, Derek?
Oh, absolutely. And Duke was, they had Gene Banks. They had
Denard.
Vince Taylor. They had great players. We had Merlin was in the league at the time. You know, had the great, the late Lynn Bias and Buck Williams and Ernie Graham. We played the number one team in the country 40 years ago 7 times, and they were all in league. And then you got Ralph Sampson, you know, who's 3-time player of the year. So every time we looked around, but you know what? That's the privilege and honor of playing the ACC, playing against the best competition. What was great about that year is that we all stayed in school for 4 years. You know, we didn't transfer right out. Everybody stayed around. It's a different mindset, different market now. But we're going to be looking at guys. We're going to be looking at brand new teams every year.
Yep.
You know, there's an average of 5 to 6 guys that's going to leave your program one way or another, through graduation, through transfer, to NIL, whatever. You're just going to have a brand new team every year. So we just got to get used to it.
Yeah, and people don't even –
question?
Go ahead, Derek, go.
I'm just curious, Derek, do you think with the advancement of the transfer portal, along with obviously players leaving for the draft, do you think that's going to affect – just the state of a lot of the historic rivalries that we've seen over the years, the Duke Carolina type of rivalries? Do you think those things take a hit because of how the transfer portal and going into the draft have advanced over the years?
I think for the fans, to your point, I think the fans like the continuity of getting to know the players, right? Getting to get close to the players and seeing them grow and coming to the games and wearing their jerseys and taking pictures with somebody who's been there two or three years. You know, there's something about it. The rivalry is not going anywhere. You know, it used to be NC State is still a great Carolina and State still a great rivalry. Duke and Carolina is the modern day rivalry, blue blood rivalry that the nation has adopted, and it's been great because both of those teams have won a lot of national championships, won a lot of games. So it's kind of, they've adopted that, but that's not going to go. The tradition and the history is not going away. You're just going to see different kids. What I could more concerned about, do the players appreciate the history and those before them? You know, when I see all of our former players like David Thompson, Tommy Bertles, and stuff, I appreciate it. What they did, and they're the reason why that NC State was so great. Well, I want the current players to feel like this is a privilege and an honor to play in such a tremendous league, no matter what school. And I think that's what our fans know, and they want to feel, and they want to embrace. And so hopefully the new kids today will feel the same way and embrace your tradition, embrace the history of playing one of the greatest leagues ever.
So, Derek, I couldn't put it any better than that, but let's move on and talk about the shot heard from around the world. Derek, for everybody that doesn't know, Derek has got a book that's releasing soon. Derek, when are you going to release your book?
It's only 1 month, baby, March. March Madness, gonna really. But listen, I'm so excited to do that, and I got to thank Hassan because you know all the great things he does as an entrepreneur and touching people and community stuff. He really inspired me to do things like this, and Hopefully he'll help me with my audio book. I'm putting the plug in. Hopefully he'll help me with my audio
book. I got you. I got you on the audio.
You got to love the old shameless plug right there.
But you know, this is a story about the shoulders that we have stood upon. It's our parents, it's our teachers, it's our mentors, it's our coaches, people who've paved the way. It's our DNA, it's our history, it's our background. So I start off with the history of my name, Wittenberg. Everybody says, how does black dude get this name, Wittenberg? Where did that come from? So I start from the origin from Germany by way of a plantation in Virginia by South Carolina, and how my uncle was a civil rights leader in South Carolina and integrated South Carolina schools, and my parents met. And then I get to all my DeMatha stuff, and when I was raised in D.C. and NC State and ESPN, I cover so many topics. It's just a memoir of the people that helped me along the way. And in the spirit of doing this book, the spirit of it is, it's about the 99% of so many people that are successful that help you along the way. I want to give them their due, right? I want to give them their credit, because without them, there will be no me. You know, to have the opportunity to get to the White House twice, to meet Ronald Reagan, I'm from Washington, D.C., and then to go meet the first black president, President Obama. You know, that's special moments, guys, to be on that lawn and give a press conference about that experience is priceless. I need to share that to young people. The 99% of people, even athletes, that's not going to play their sport again. We got to get back to education. That's why all of us on this podcast right now, if we didn't have a great education, great character, and a willingness to help people, we would be nowhere. So I want to get back to, we've forgotten about the 99%. The 99% of people who excel in so great things, but they're not on TV, they're not catching a ball, they're not singing and dancing, but they're doing some great things. That's what my book's about, to honor the ones that have helped me.
That's Derek, that's
awesome. How many copies you want?
And Derek, I also want to point out that you are the executive producer of Survive in Advance, and I believe you won some Emmy Awards on that. Wow. And in addition to that, you did the Morton Wooten film as well. Is that correct, Derek?
Yes, and the Survive in Advance produced 10 years ago, 2013, actually 11 years ago, is the most watched sports documentary in the world. And at Christmas time, when they started to show it in March and at the end of in April, you know, even Christmas, you know, 58 million people watched Survive in Advance. And it's just a story about Jim Valvano and a group of ordinary guys that achieved something very extraordinary nobody thought we could do. And the reason why I had an opportunity to do it, because I got fired as a coach at Fordham. And I go around the country, tell everybody, say, oh, you got fired. Oh, my God, they think it's the worst thing in the world. Well, if I didn't get fired as a coach, I wouldn't have an opportunity to produce that film. So I turned something that appears to be negative, I turned it into a positive. And so now that film is being watched and it empowered so many people. I had several coaches, I won't mention, that actually have shown that to their team. Show Survive in Advance during this time, how you got to persevere, and the whole phrase about surviving and advancing. Surviving and advancing, that's what we do every day, not just in sports. So it was an honor for me to have an opportunity to tell a story. The other film that you did not mention that you guys is a must-see is that I was part of a team that produced a 10-part series of the history of the ACC tournament called The Tourney. And it gives you the history from the time that Everett Case came here, from the Dixie Classic, you know, to Charlie Scott and to David Thompson, and to the great game that the 50th anniversary of the 73-74 game, doing double overtime to change college basketball, because Maryland and NC State went a double overtime and State won, and only one team could go to the tournament. So that film is historic in itself. They should be a requirement that every kid that plays basketball in the league should watch The Tourney so they can understand the history about this league. Every kid, it should be mandatory that they watch this film. So I'm excited. It's a nightmare through the influence of Hassan and my journey of getting outside the box, not being in coaching, but allowing me to spread my wings and to be more involved in the community, to come back to NC State and do the things that I love to do, and that's empowering people and helping people in their journey. That's what we all do. We are sharing information on this podcast to do what? Sharing information to help our fans at our prospective schools, help kids, and inspire them that they can do great things and they can do podcasts and they can do whatever they want if they put their mind to it.
Let me ask you, Derek, I'm really curious on a lighter note. Was it a pass or a shot?
Well,
that was an air ball, man. Come on.
Well, you probably wasn't born.
I'll be honest. I've seen the documentary 10 times. When you're talking about it being the most watched, I've seen it at least 10 times.
I'm saying because you was young back then, you know, I used the shot on the book because that's what people think it was. But everybody know, even 40 years later, it was a pass. Everybody knows that.
I love it.
That's fair. I did read that it was a pass. So I had to ask you.
Well, guys, do yourself a favor. Trust me. Watch the tourney. Go back and watch that. And you guys just should have a segment on that. Because I'm telling you, you talking about history, it's tremendous, guys. You're going to have more appreciation for this league than ever. There was great coaches, great players, great personalities as coaches that we had in that league. The late Terry Holland, you got Lefty Giselle that was in the league when Merlin was in the league. You got Dean, of course, and Coach K, Valvano. You had Bobby Crimmins. I mean, you got some great personalities that was in this league. This league was built on players and coaches with personalities. It was an honor and privilege for me to play. And by the way, two schools, guys. I coached at Georgia Tech and I coached at NC State on two different occasions. So I've seen it from on both sides, you know, right, as being an opponent, walking in my own gym, when I was with Georgia Tech, and being on the other side, and now I'm an administrator. So it's just a special, special league, and I'm glad to have the opportunity to play in it.
And, Derek, outside of basketball, can you tell us a little bit about your foundation? I've been kind of reading up on the work you guys do, and it just sounds incredible. So give yourself
it's in my name, but my wife is the engine behind that. We started in 2015 where we raised money to help juniors and seniors finish college. And our goal is to help every university system school in North Carolina. And we're excited about it. I mean, to at least see those, and no athletes now, guys, no athletes. And we are at $1 million given out, over 200 scholarships. And to see those kids, they don't even know who Derek Whitmer is. And they get to the scholarship and they got their housing paid for. They got their food paid. I mean, it's just incredible to see the look of those kids' face. They help them finish. And we have a criteria that it's about your hardship. We don't care where you came from, what you look like. We don't have no pictures. We just want you to tell your story, and if we can help, you can. And I think it's probably one of the most powerful things that I do, besides the V Foundation, because I've been on the board of the V Foundation for 30 years, and we've done great work there as well. And so I get the best to work both worlds. I get to work at my alma mater every day from 8 to 5, and then from 5 p.m. to 12 p.m., I get to do and helping people every day. Me and my wife, we probably average 100 and over 190 something events a year, supporting the community. And we just believe in, if we, everybody helps each other a little bit, we all can grow together. And I'm just excited to be back in North Carolina, where it's probably my home. And I just like, you know, helping people and helping kids. That's what it's all about, guys. It's about service.
Well, Derek, we could talk to you for hours and hours and hours. But what we're going to have to do is get you back on. When the book drops on Amazon, on any of the book outlets, we're going to have to bring you on in March, and we're going to talk about Duke Carolina, ACC play. So I think we're going to have you back. And Derek, thank you for being a great friend. Thank you for being a great human. Thank you for the shot heard around the world. This has been episode 13, has been fantastic. Derek Wittenberg, amazing. And we're going to have him back, guys. And I want to thank again, I want to thank Derek Wittenberg. I want to thank my partners, Daryl Brunson, Will Phelan, for rocking with us this past hour, for talking ACC basketball, for talking Duke Carolina State basketball. And if you love this podcast, share it with your friends. If you love this podcast, share it with your friends, because we want to continue to grow this podcast. And if you want to donate to the podcast, you can donate at BlueBloodRivalry.com. And guys, I think we had another fantastic show. Don't you agree?
Oh, yeah.
Blue. All right. And as we always say, we out.
We out.
The Blue Blood TV podcast is available on Spotify, iTunes, or wherever you get your podcasts. Remember, guys, these shows grow when you share them. So we have a great show here. Share with all your friends. Make them aware of the Blue Blood TV podcast.